parecía inminente. O por lo menos
a war appeared imminent. A first strike might take place at any time. I said to myself, if Cuba is in such an unfortunate war, we will disappear from the map.
Nosotros vamos a desaparecer del mapa.
Robert Kennedy came to me and said, Mr. Ambassador, the situation is very tense. Your missiles have just shot down our plane. Our generals demand that we retaliate. If we start bombing, you will fight back. What can we do?
It was a perfectly beautiful night, as fall nights are in Washington. I walked out of the President's Oval Office, and as I walked out, I thought I might never live to see another Saturday night.
La Guerra Fría, Cuba, 1959-1962. Durante los años 40 y 50, la isla caribeña de Cuba había sido el patio de juegos de Estados Unidos con sus playas, bares y casinos. La Habana lo tenía todo. El territorio cubano y la industria pertenecían casi totalmente a corporaciones estadounidenses.
We consider part of the United States practically, just a wonderful little country over there that was of no danger to anybody. As a matter of fact, was a rather important economic asset to the United States.
El líder de Cuba, Fulgencio Batista, era un cruel dictador. El pueblo se estaba poniendo en su contra. Tras años de lucha guerrillera en las montañas, el carismático abogado de 33 años, Fidel Castro, entró en La Habana el 8 de enero de 1959.
Cuando triunfó la revolución,
the triumph of the revolution was an example of order. There was no looting. No one was dragged along the streets. There were no murders, no crimes. There was perfect order.
Un orden perfecto.
En este orden perfecto, más de 500 miembros del régimen anterior fueron acusados de crímenes contra el pueblo. Después fueron juzgados y ejecutados. Temerosos de la llegada de un nuevo dictador, miles de cubanos se exiliaron en Estados Unidos. Pero para la mayoría, Castro era un héroe.
La revolución prometió empleo a la población.
The revolution promised to provide jobs for the people.
Que no había existido.
It promised honesty in the administration, which had never existed in Cuba. There were health programs, which had never existed before. Education programs, which had never existed before.
Pero lo más importante fue que Castro nacionalizó los millones de hectáreas de tierra, propiedad de compañías estadounidenses, y se los dio al pueblo. Ansioso por anunciarle al mundo su revolución, Castro viajó a Nueva York para hablar en las Naciones Unidas. El presidente Eisenhower estaba demasiado ocupado para recibirlo, pero el líder soviético Nikita Khrushchev estaba encantado de conocer al nuevo revolucionario y le ofreció ayuda económica.
Cuba decide comprar petróleo soviético.
Cuba decided to buy oil from the Soviet Union, which would be cheaper.
The country could also get credit from the Soviet Union, who were willing to help us. But the American companies refused to refine the oil.
Castro, al no contar con ningún lugar donde refinar el petróleo soviético, se enfrentaba al desastre económico. Le ordenó a su milicia que se apoderara de las refinerías extranjeras en Cuba. La venganza estadounidense fue inmediata.
At his White House press conference, President Eisenhower announces that Cuba's assigned share of the United States sugar market has been cut by 95% in reply to what I call Fidel Castro's deliberate policy of hostility.
A medida que aumentaba la tensión, Castro nacionalizaba más de $1,000 millones de inversiones estadounidenses. En tono iracundo, el presidente Eisenhower decretó un embargo comercial total y le ordenó a la CIA reclutar exiliados cubanos. Serían entrenados para destruir el régimen de Castro.
Las agencias del gobierno de
Government agencies of the United States began training people to bomb Cuba and to burn the sugarcane fields. They used small planes with incendiary devices to set fire to the fields.
Y venían las avionetas con sustancias inflamables y nos quemaban.
It was very serious. This was the only wealth we had.
Desarrollando una guerra sucia.
They carried out a dirty war against our country. Guerrilla units were active in every province, even in Havana.
Más de 100 personas murieron cuando La Cubre, un carguero que transportaba armas y municiones de Bélgica, explotó en el puerto de La Habana. Se sospechó de un sabotaje de la CIA, pero nunca se probó nada. Castro le pidió ayuda a la Unión Soviética.
Perhaps he might have taken a different line had the Americans been more mild towards him than they actually were. The Cold War, it was in its full bloom. So whatever was unpleasant to the Americans was welcomed in this country, and vice versa, I would say.
En una base secreta en la selva guatemalteca, los agentes estadounidenses de la CIA habían estado entrenando a los exiliados cubanos para que invadieran Cuba. Pensaron que este sería el impulso que necesitaba el pueblo cubano para sublevarse y derrocar a Castro. El plan le fue presentado al nuevo presidente, John F. Kennedy.
Kennedy felt that a plan that he had inherited, under which a band of Cuban exiles were to liberate their own country, was one he could hardly turn his back on. Surely the United States should help get rid of a communist dictatorship in our hemisphere.
La CIA engañó al nuevo presidente. Le prometió una victoria fácil y ponerle fin al problema cubano. Kennedy estuvo de acuerdo con la invasión, pero exigió cambios sustanciales para ocultar la participación estadounidense. Solo 3 días antes de la invasión, Kennedy negó cualquier posibilidad de intervención de Estados Unidos.
There will not be under any conditions be an intervention in Cuba by United States Armed Forces. And this government will do everything it possibly can, and I think it can meet its responsibilities to make sure that there are no Americans involved in any actions inside Cuba.
Mientras Kennedy hablaba, se reunía la fuerza de invasión. Un grupo de bombarderos planeaba destruir la fuerza aérea de Castro en tierra. El presidente, preocupado de que esto pudiera revelar la participación de Washington, ordenó que se redujera el tamaño de la operación. El 15 de abril de 1961, Solamente 6 bombarderos estadounidenses disfrazados con los colores de la Fuerza Aérea Cubana despegaron de Nicaragua para un ataque decisivo en los campos de aviación cubanos. Pero con tan pocos bombarderos, solo fueron destruidos 3 aviones cubanos. 7 civiles murieron. Mientras enterraban a los que habían muerto, Castro, que buscaba el apoyo soviético, declaró finalmente que la revolución era socialista.
Porque lo que no pueden perdonarnos los imperialistas es que estemos aquí y que hayamos hecho una revolución socialista en las propias narices de los Estados Unidos.
Continuamos preparando. Resistir una...
We prepared ourselves to resist an invasion against all the forces we knew the Americans had at their disposal.
Al día siguiente, solamente 1,500 exiliados, equipados con armas y municiones estadounidenses, llegaron a Bahía de Cochinos, a 201 kilómetros al sur de La Habana.
Éramos los hombres más felices del mundo.
We were the happiest men in the world because we had the opportunity to return to Cuba, our homeland, to fight to rescue freedom and democracy so that our country could be for all Cubans.
Los aviones estadounidenses protegerían a la fuerza de invasión mientras esta atacaba la playa. Pero Kennedy, que ahora enfrentaba la desaprobación internacional por el bombardeo inicial, suspendió el apoyo aéreo. Un grupo de la Fuerza Aérea de Castro rápidamente destruyó los barcos que transportaban los importantes suministros de municiones. Cuba movilizó todas sus fuerzas porque creyó que esta era una invasión estadounidense a gran escala.
Los peores momentos eran los iniciales, cuando teníamos poca información de
The worst moments were at the beginning. We didn't have much information about the enemy.
No sabíamos.
We didn't know if they were 1,000, 3,000 or 10,000. We didn't know what types of weapons they might have. We didn't know if this was a total invasion.
Si podía provocarse una invasión.
Sin el apoyo aéreo estadounidense ni el suministro de municiones, la fuerza de invasión se vio superada en número y armas. En 72 horas, los invasores fueron capturados o asesinados.
Yo no me di cuenta de que esta misión ya estaba resultando imposible.
I did not realize that the mission was impossible until the last day, almost at the end.
Porque teníamos un exceso de
confianza. We trusted in our allies. We never thought they would forsake us or abandon us. We didn't think that they could betray the commitment they had with us.
Jack Kennedy was devastated by the fiasco at the Bay of Pigs, and he said it was a fiasco. He was not accustomed to failure in politics or in life. And he was more distraught than I'd ever seen him. How could I have been so stupid, he said.
Castro había sobrevivido y había humillado a Kennedy. La CIA tuvo que planear algo de nuevo.
Our job was to start to come up with new plans, not a Bay of Pigs type plans, but new plans to, quote, get rid of Castro and the Castro regime, unquote.
Se consideraron varias cosas, desde el asesinato hasta esparcir LSD en un estudio de televisión para que pareciera que Castro se había vuelto loco. Todo lo que ideaban, Castro lo sorteaba. Más seguro en su propio país, Castro buscó exportar la revolución al resto de América Latina. Alarmado por esta posibilidad, Estados Unidos mantuvo la presión sobre Castro. En la primavera de 1962, 40,000 marines estadounidenses escenificaron una invasión simulada de una isla caribeña.
We did that purposely to make Castro pay more attention to that than causing trouble in Latin and Central America. But the Cubans and the Russians, they told us later, believe that the United States really did intend to attack Cuba, and therefore Castro kept saying, I need some help.
Las súplicas de Castro llevaron al líder Khrushchev a hacerle una audaz oferta. Este había alardeado ante el mundo acerca del poderío nuclear de Rusia, pero en realidad sabía cuán limitada era su fuerza de misiles de largo alcance. Sin embargo, sí contaba con misiles de mediano alcance.
From the territory of the Soviet Union, they couldn't possibly reach the territory of the USA. But deployed on Cuba, they would become strategic nuclear weapons. That meant, in practical terms, we had a chance to narrow the differences between our forces.
I immediately appreciated the strategic importance of the presence of those missiles in Cuba. By that time, the Americans had already transported similar missiles to Turkey. I thought, if we expected the Soviets to fight on our behalf, to run risks for us, and even involve themselves in a war for our sake, it would be immoral and cowardly on our part to refuse to accept the presence of those missiles here.
En julio de 1962, bajo las narices de los estadounidenses, el primero de los 150 barcos soviéticos zarpó hacia Cuba, cargado con misiles nucleares muy bien camuflados y más de 40.000 tropas.
The Americans just didn't notice that we managed to deliver not one, but 43,000 people there, plus the equipment, weapons, and everything necessary for the installation work. We put all the cars, trucks, and tractors on the top. All the military equipment was hidden under the decks.
Los agentes de la CIA en Cuba informaron que habían visto tropas rusas y remolques de misiles en las calles de La Habana. Washington le restó importancia a la información y la calificó de rumor.
Yo vi aquella arma rara.
I saw those weird weapons. And then I said to my friend Pablo,
le dije a Pablo,
Pablo, how powerful are these weird weapons? And he answered, these are nuclear missiles. So I thought, oh, really powerful. They just put them here, out in the open.
Pero la CIA había notado que más barcos soviéticos se dirigían hacia Cuba. El 14 de octubre, se le ordenó a un avión espía U-2 que sobrevolara la isla para tratar de descubrir qué era lo que pasaba. A la mañana siguiente, el Centro de Interpretación Fotográfica en Washington analizó las fotografías que había tomado el U-2.
We're looking at the photography, and we spot objects that are foreign to the environment. And we kept looking, and we said, uh-oh, this is an SS-4 ballistic missile site. So working with the photo interpreters, we became convinced that this was it.
The Soviets had never put any nuclear weapons outside the Soviet borders. And we didn't think they'd do it, you know. The truth of the matter is that it never dawned on us that they would take that kind of risk.
A las 8:45 a.m. del 16 de octubre, la CIA le informó a Kennedy que sin duda alguna había misiles soviéticos en Cuba. El presidente se reunió con sus consejeros en la Casa Blanca.
We didn't spend a great deal of time wondering why the Soviets were doing this, because why they had done it, for whatever reason they had done it, they had done it in a surreptitious way, lying to the United States through a variety of messages and messengers that they were only putting defensive weapons into Cuba, and those weapons constituted a clear and present danger to our security.
Los misiles en Cuba hicieron que los estadounidenses fuesen más vulnerables que nunca. Los rusos estaban tan cerca que podían atacar sin aviso.
The first strike would have knocked out all the American air bases, bomber bases, all the American missile bases, and all American cities except Seattle, which was out of their range. But Washington, D.C., New York City, Dallas would have all gone under the hammer.
We talked about the possibility of an airstrike, which was, at one time or another, almost everybody's first choice upon first thought, to knock out the missiles. We talked about an invasion of Cuba, which was always the preferred choice of the right wing, go in and take Cuba away from Castro and rid the island of communism while at the same time getting rid of these missiles. A diplomatic approach, either bilaterally or through the United Nations. A blockade, or quarantine, as it later came to be called. No decision was made at that first meeting. But if a vote had been taken there, airstrike was probably number one on everybody's list.
A Robert Kennedy, hermano del presidente y su más cercano consejero, le preocupaba que, en caso de que Estados Unidos atacara sin previo aviso a una pequeña isla, el mundo entero se volvería en su contra.
Robert Kennedy, rightfully, in my opinion, drew the analogy that it would be regarded by the world as a bombing of Cuba, of bases in Cuba, comparable to the bombing of Pearl Harbor by the Japanese in 1941. And he said, I don't think I want my brother to become another Tojo.
Mientras continuaban las discusiones, el ministro soviético de Relaciones Exteriores Andrei Gromyko y el embajador Anatoly Dobrynin intentaron un acuerdo a largo plazo en la Casa Blanca.
The president raised the question of the increasing tension between our two countries in connection with the Soviet deliveries of weapons. The president said, we're worried about it, because it's connected with our own safety and security. Gromyko told him, just as I was told to say, that all our deliveries, Mr. President, are of a defensive nature. If you don't intend to invade Cuba, you shouldn't worry, because all the weapons are defensive.
It was a clear intent to deceive. If the U.S. were not to respond to Soviet deception, how would this influence the attitude of our NATO allies? How would they view the U.S. guarantee of their security? And how would it influence the future behavior of the Soviet Union? If they got by with deception once, couldn't they do it again?
Durante los dos días siguientes, Kennedy se mantuvo alejado porque estaba ocupado en la campaña electoral del Congreso. In Washington, sus consejeros trataban de encontrar una solución.
There were no good solutions. Every solution was full of holes and risks. It was the only time during my 3 years in the White House that I would wake up in the middle of the night agonizing over what was the right approach, what would work, what would not blow up the world.
Se llegó a una conclusión. No atacarían, pero sí impondrían un bloqueo. La Marina detendría a todos los barcos que se dirigieran a Cuba. A esto lo denominaron la cuarentena.
It was believed that the quarantine would convey to Khrushchev the determination of the president to see that those missiles were removed without stimulating a military response.
Pero si la cuarentena no funcionaba, Estados Unidos se preparaba para lanzar ataques aéreos, además de tener lista su fuerza de invasión masiva. El presidente Kennedy se encontraba en Chicago. Ahora se le necesitaba en Washington. La prensa comenzaba a sospechar.
I was called by President Kennedy at 8 o'clock in the morning, and he said, "Come to my room." And he still had his bathrobe on, and he said, "Here's something I'm writing for you. You're going to hold a press conference to announce it."
The assistant White House physician, Dr. George Berkeley, noticed that the president's voice was very husky.
Next morning, when he examined the president, he found the president had developed a slight temperature and that he was suffering from a minor upper respiratory ailment. The president therefore canceled his schedule for the rest of today and tomorrow and has returned to Washington and the White House.
About halfway to Washington, I suddenly found myself alone with Kennedy in the front part of the airplane. I said, Mr. President, you're not sick. What the hell's going on? He said to me, you're going to find out as soon as you land in Washington and then grab your balls.
Everyone, an unusual flurry of top secret military and diplomatic activity over the weekend has Washington guessing today that a major move in American foreign policy may be imminent. The speculation centers on the Caribbean and possible action against Cuba.
Esa tarde, el embajador soviético fue llamado urgentemente para una reunión con el secretario de Estado, Dean Rusk.
Rusk said, you are delivering missiles to Cuba. We have aerial reconnaissance photographs. This is a threat to our security, and we cannot possibly allow it. In 1 hour's time, at 7 p.m., the president will make a radio and television appeal to the American people, where he will describe the situation. At the same time, he wants you to pass the message on to Khrushchev.
A las 7 en punto, Kennedy le anunció al mundo por primera vez que existían misiles soviéticos en Cuba y que el bloqueo ahora estaba en proceso.
The purpose of these bases can be none other than to provide a nuclear strike capability against the Western Hemisphere. To halt this offensive buildup, a strict quarantine on all offensive military equipment under shipment to Cuba is being initiated. All ships of any kind bound for Cuba, from whatever nation or port, will, if found to contain cargoes of offensive weapons, be turned back. I call upon Chairman Khrushchev to halt and eliminate this clandestine, reckless, and provocative threat to world peace and to stable relations between our two nations. He has an opportunity now to move the world back from the abyss of destruction.
La primera respuesta provino de Moscú a la mañana siguiente. Khrushchev no iba a retroceder.
Kennedy spoke about quarantine, and that sounded as something not very precise, perhaps not a blockade as it actually was. So the first reactions were pretty tough from the Soviet side.
Denouncing the United States arms quarantine against Cuba as a step toward world thermonuclear war, the Soviet Union today ordered its armed forces into a state of combat readiness. And forces of the Warsaw Pact, the communist counterpart of the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, immediately followed suit.
A medida que las superpotencias se preparaban para el conflicto, Cuba anunció una preparación para el combate. Más de un cuarto de millón de personas se ofrecieron como voluntarios para evitar la invasión estadounidense.
Sentimos un peligro bastante
grande. We felt the danger.
Inclusive, figúrese, el país también.
This was war. The country could be invaded at any time by the Americans.
If they invaded our country, I was convinced it would create the grave risk of the U.S. taking the second step of carrying out a nuclear airstrike against the Soviet Union.
La flota estadounidense rodeaba a Cuba. Los barcos soviéticos seguían su curso. Ante la inminente confrontación, Kennedy quería comunicarse directamente con Moscú. Envió a su hermano Robert a reunirse en secreto con el embajador soviético.
He said, "Did your government instruct the captains to turn the ships back home because Kennedy introduced the quarantine?" I said, "No. Our captains have no such orders. And as far as I'm aware, they are instructed to go on to Cuba." According to international law, You have no right to stop our ships in the open sea. You cannot draw an imaginary line which cannot be crossed. It is against the law. He replied, well then, I don't know where we are heading.
The Pentagon says the United States is ready to sink every communist bloc ship headed for Cuba which refuses to stop and be searched under the blockade. Further, force will be used if necessary to stop and search any ship of any nation bound for Cuba.
I think that was the moment that really was the heart stopper. I recall being in the newsroom just waiting for that next bulletin and almost literally trying to type with my fingers crossed.
Let's check over at the Pentagon with Charles von Fremd on that. Chuck, is there any late information about the position of those Soviet ships or what might be happening to them?
Walter, we haven't heard a word for several hours now as to when the confrontation between U.S. Vessels and the Soviet ships will come about.
La tensión era cada vez mayor. El pueblo estadounidense trataba de prepararse para un posible holocausto nuclear. Una ola de pánico recorría todo Estados Unidos.
We have a utility room where the furnaces are, and we're wondering whether we can make that into a bomb shelter of some form. We were learning for the first time the time that we would have after the explosion before the fumes, the killing fumes, killing heat and so forth would reach us.
Los líderes soviéticos habían tratado de que el pueblo no supiera nada de la crisis, pero las noticias estaban llegando.
The people felt the breath of war and were tense. I remember my parents felt doomed. They understood that war would not be like it was before, that it would be a war with atomic bombs.
This is a special report from CBS News. At its beginning, this day looked as though it might be one of armed conflict between Soviet vessels and American warships on the sea lanes leading to Cuba. But there has been no confrontation as far as we know, and some hope has been generated by suggestions of negotiation.
Casi en el último momento, los barcos con los misiles aparentemente disminuyeron la velocidad o alteraron su curso. Esa noche, mientras Kennedy cenaba con algunos amigos en la Casa Blanca, se propuso hacer un brindis para celebrar. Kennedy se rehusó. El juego, dijo, aún no ha terminado. A las 9:24 p.m., el Departamento de Estado recibió una carta de Khrushchev para el presidente. Khrushchev rechazó todas las exigencias de Kennedy. Los misiles en Cuba estaban siendo preparados para la acción. Por primera vez en la historia, el Comando Estratégico Aéreo de Estados Unidos inició la condición de defensa 2. El siguiente paso, DEFCON 1, sería la guerra. Justo después del amanecer de la mañana del 25, Kennedy ordenó la detención del Bucarest, un barco que transportaba petróleo soviético. Sabía que no había posibilidades de que un tanquero petrolero transportase misiles, pero era una señal para Khrushchev de que Kennedy hablaba muy en serio. Esa tarde, en las Naciones Unidas, Adlai Stevenson enfrentó a su colega soviético, el embajador Zorin.
All right, sir. Let me ask you one simple question. Do you, Ambassador Zorin, deny that the USSR has placed and is placing medium and intermediate range missiles and sites in Cuba? Yes or no? Don't wait for the translation, yes or no?
Я не нахожусь в американском суде.
I'm not
I am not in an American courtroom, sir, and therefore I do not wish to answer a question that is put to me in the fashion in which a prosecutor does. In due course, sir, you will have your reply.
You're in a court of world opinion right now, and you can answer yes or no. You have denied that they exist. I want to know if I've understood you correctly.
Mientras el embajador soviético mentía, las fotografías del U-2 fueron mostradas en la reunión para que el mundo entero las viera. El trabajo continuaba en los lugares donde estaban los misiles en Cuba y se incrementaban las fuerzas de invasión estadounidenses en Florida. Se estaban preparando para el combate convencional. No se habían dado cuenta de que las fuerzas soviéticas estaban equipadas con misiles tácticos de corto alcance, con ojivas atómicas listas para aniquilar a cualquier invasor.
If they'd started an invasion using the Marines or the airborne forces, the losses would have been enormous. We would have fought to the last soldier, the last bullet. There was nowhere to retreat to.
On the 26th of October, at a meeting with the Soviet military commander, I was informed about the state of the missiles. He told me, the air regiment is ready. The surface-to-air missiles are ready. The tactical nuclear missile unit is ready. Missiles ready.
La unidad de cohetes lista.
El 26 de octubre, en medio de la creciente tensión, Kennedy recibió un telegrama de Khrushchev.
The most important paragraph in it is, Mr. President, Mr. Kennedy, you and I are like two men pulling on a rope with a knot in the middle. The harder we pull, the tighter the knot until it will have to be cut with a sword. Why don't we both let up the pressure and maybe we can untie the knot?
Khrushchev apareció para hacer una oferta. Si Estados Unidos declaraba que no invadiría Cuba, nuestros especialistas militares en Cuba se retirarán. Finalmente, parecía que el diálogo razonable prevalecería. Pero todo había cambiado a la mañana siguiente. Khrushchev trataba de forzar un mejor acuerdo y exigía un trato. Sus misiles en Cuba por los misiles estadounidenses en Turquía.
Khrushchev thought that if the withdrawal from Turkey could be incorporated in a general agreement between the two sides, that would look very good for the Soviet Union, much even better than a simple decision by the United States not to attack Cuba.
El presidente Kennedy estaba preparado para retirar los misiles de Turquía, pero eran parte de la contribución de Estados Unidos a la OTAN, así que no podía hacerle promesas a Khrushchev. Mientras consideraba las ofertas, Kennedy recibió noticias de que la crisis había aumentado de nuevo. En continuos vuelos de reconocimiento, el avión espía U-2 sobrevoló la base antiaérea soviética al este de Cuba. Esta vez, el comandante soviético dio la orden de lanzar un misil tierra-aire contra el avión.
The division commander, Lieutenant Colonel Gurchikov, was given the order to liquidate the target.
Что он и блестяще выполнил. Если бы не сбили самолет...
If we hadn't shot down the plane which had photographed all of our bases, it would have enabled the enemy to destroy us. That would have meant we had not fulfilled our mission. We would have betrayed our motherland.
The kind of standby plan was if a Su-2 was shot down, we would immediately bomb that SAM site out of existence. President Kennedy canceled that order. He said, don't bomb anti-aircraft site. I want time to exchange with Khrushchev.
La guerra se desatara. Parecía inminente.
A war appeared imminent. O por lo menos a first strike might take place at any time.
Parecía inminente que se produjera un ataque. Digo, si
Cuba, I said to myself, if Cuba is in such an unfortunate war, we will disappear from the map.
Nosotros vamos a desaparecer del mapa.
Castro le envió un mensaje a Khrushchev. Dijo que un ataque estadounidense estaba a solo horas de distancia y una vez lanzado, la Unión Soviética debería tomar represalias inmediatamente con un ataque devastador. En Washington, Kennedy estaba todavía tratando de evitar una guerra mundial.
Bobby Kennedy had this brilliant idea. He said, let's pick out of the Khrushchev cable the things we like and pretend that the rest isn't there. Jack Kennedy and Bobby Kennedy those crafted this answer to Khrushchev that did just that. It ignored the shoot down of the U-2. It ignored the broadcast from Moscow that was very hawkish, you know, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And just, we said, we understand what you are proposing, and then we listed the things we liked.
Tenían poca confianza de que esta idea funcionase. Los planes de invadir continuaban.
The tension on Saturday night was extraordinary because it was going to be the meeting where we were going to decide what time the next day we were going to invade Cuba, or was it going to be later? Were we going to be bombing those areas? And Kennedy started the meeting by saying, listen, all of you have not been home for at least 6-7 days. I want all of you to go home tonight, come back tomorrow morning, Sunday morning, and we'll make the decision Sunday morning.
Salieron de la Casa Blanca temerosos de que Estados Unidos pudiese empezar una guerra nuclear. Guerra que, una vez comenzada, no sería fácil de detener.
It was a perfectly beautiful night, as fall nights are in Washington. I walked out of the President's Oval Office, and as I walked out, I thought I might never live to see another Saturday night.
Kennedy envió a su hermano a otro encuentro con el embajador soviético.
He came to me and said, the situation is very tense. Your missiles have just shot down our plane. Our generals demand that we fight back. If we start bombing, you will start to fight back. What can we do? I said, what about Turkey? He thought for a while and said, you know, if that's the only condition which prevents us from striking a deal, then I'm authorized by the president to say that we agree to it.
We could not take them out under threat. We could not take them out unilaterally because they were NATO bases. But he had our assurance that they would be gone provided it was not done on a quid pro quo basis. And therefore, the Russians could not talk about it.
And that was, I would say, the last thing that led to the decision to accept Kennedy's terms, that he would be willing to guarantee that there would be no attack on Cuba, but that the Soviet Union should withdraw all offensive weapons from Cuba.
Khrushchev temía que esta fuese la última posibilidad de evitar una guerra, así que envió un mensaje a Radio Moscú en el que aceptaba las condiciones de Kennedy. El mensaje fue transmitido al mundo.
The Soviet government has ordered the dismantling of weapons in Cuba, as well as their quaking and return to the Soviet Union.
Radio Moscow at 9 o'clock this morning. Mr. Khrushchev crating up his missiles and shipping them home.
The first news I heard on Sunday morning when I woke up was this broadcast from Khrushchev over the open air that Soviet missiles were to be withdrawn under inspection and the crisis was over. I could hardly believe my ears.
This is the day we have every reason to believe when the world came out from under the most terrible threat of nuclear holocaust since the end of World War II.
Nosotros realmente nos sentimos indignados.
We were irate. How did we learn about this? Through the radio, on the morning of the 28th. They broadcast that an agreement had been reached between the Soviet Union and the United States, that Kennedy was offering Khrushchev a guarantee. It really was a disgraceful agreement. It never crossed my mind they would do anything like this.
The whole world was under the impression that Khrushchev had lost because he'd given in to the pressure of a strong president, that he'd taken everything out of Cuba, but got nothing in return. No one knew about the agreement regarding the missiles in Turkey. If you ask who won or who lost, I'd say neither Kennedy nor Khrushchev.
Bajo la vigilancia estadounidense, los barcos soviéticos se llevaron los misiles consigo.
There is no question that if it hadn't been solved, we had invaded Cuba, we would have been in a nuclear war. And the number of people who would have been killed around the world in that nuclear war would have been absolutely disastrous. That was the biggest crisis of the 20th century. And the fact that Kennedy solved it with Khrushchev is absolutely important because then we were moving into a totally different world.